Good morning. So incredibly overwhelmed by the response that you guys have continued to give and to begin to pray for Ukraine and for Russia and for Belarus. Man, we've said it again and again. God's desire is that none should perish. God's desire is that their peace would reign in the earth. God's desires is that war would cease. But we're believing for divine solutions. If you've been watching the news, if you've been reading the news, then you are most likely overwhelmed. You're probably depressed. You're probably in despair. You're probably in hopelessness. But God, God is not. God, one of my favorite scriptures is Psalm 22. It says that the King, that the Lord sits in heaven and laughs. What's he laughing at? He's laughing that the people on earth, the kings, are raging together. They are plotting against the Lord and his anointed, plotting Christ's crucifixion. And Christ is like, God's like, eh, really? God is not impressed with the devil. And we can't afford to be either. But we will naturally be overwhelmed, naturally in despair, not naturally in depression, naturally in these places of fear, just by looking at what's happening, unless we turn our hearts towards him, unless we feed ourselves on what he is doing, unless we feed ourselves on what he has shown us in his word about his nature. And so rather than to be overwhelmed, rather than to be in fear, we're going to lean into the praise reports of the things that are actually happening on the ground. We're going to feed ourselves on what he says in his word. And then from that place of courage and place of hope, we're going to look into the dark places. We're going to bring light to the darkness. We cannot address the darkness if we're not impressed with our King, unless we see his power and his might. Oh, man, guys, we have an amazing team on here today. I see Lisa Darden. I see Ann Say. I know there are so many others. If you need prayer for anything, just say need prayer, and they'd love to pray for you. As always, if you want these in a printed form, go to ariselife.org/Ukraine. But also, please share this. Pray. Get the word out. This is so important. Get the word out. Raise up prayer, because prayer is working. Listen, all the talking heads, man, they keep trying to cover themselves and explain past events, but they cannot explain all the miracles that are happening. They cannot explain how we got here day 35 and we're still, Ukraine is not crumbling, not bowing, but pushing back. So let's celebrate. Let's take a look at the good things that are happening. One of the things that we've prayed is that we prayed specifically for this, because all the way along, the West, US and Europe, have been telling Russia what they would not do. Russia, we're not going to do this. We're not going to do that. And Russia said, oh, you're not doing that? Okay, well, boom, we'll take over. No. Over and over again, they have told Putin exactly their playbook. And we've prayed, stop talking and start acting. It's happening. Come on, for the first time. As we said this, Biden had a slip up, apparently, in Poland, saying Putin's got to go. And then they tried to walk it back, and Biden's like, no, he's got to go. Then they said, if they use weapons of mass destruction, we will hit back with catastrophic effect. And they said, well, what would that look like? And again, he said, I'm not going to tell you. It's going to be bad, though. Why is that important? Because by refusing to put themselves in a box, they open options for them to address the situation. But again, we said, enough talk, let's see some action. Yesterday, 4 battleships sailed within kilometers of Russia's territory in Kaliningrad. 2 guided missile cruisers, or destroyers, of the United States, and a couple ships from Germany. Why? They're positioned to bring devastation. That's important. Second thing is, they now have B-52s flying in operational sequences within kilometers of the Ukraine border. Again, these are ships that can deliver real consequence to Russia. Praise God. That's incredible. Because, again, there's this a fundamental shift from talking and saying what we're not going to do, and then to now not putting themselves in a box, but actually acting and bringing some chutzpah, some meat to the conversation. Wow. Another thing is, Ukraine has finally taken the battle to Russia. They blew up a munitions depot in Belgorod, just across the Ukrainian-Russian border. Man, that's huge, because they're saying, listen, because the Russians want to deny this is happening. They want to deny the reality of this, and it's bringing it. But on top of that, there are rumors in Kursk, to the north of Belgorod, that there are rumors of airstrikes and saboteurs among them, and so on and so forth. There's rumors of Belgorod being evacuated, and so there's a freak out that's starting to happen. This is also really important, because one of the things the Russians have done in recent days, they said they've been trying to bring troops from far inland Russia, where their deaths will not evoke a result. But the people who live close to Ukraine, this is actually bringing the reality of what's happening in a real way. So, this is exciting. This is a massive development. Pray again for the Russian people to wake up. Praise God that the U.S. and the West is finally not falling for Russian talk. Again and again, Russia's like, oh, well, when they would start to act like they're going to negotiate, Europe and the West would lean on Ukraine to capitulate, because they just want this to end. But they're starting to recognize publicly that Russia talks but does nothing, does the exact opposite. And so when Russia, in negotiations yesterday in Turkey, said, hey, you know what, as an act of good faith, we're going to pull back from our fighting around Kyiv and in the north up by Chernihiv, the U.S. and U.K. and Zelensky all said, don't believe it. 3 hours later, they bombed Chernihiv. Praise God, they finally are waking up to the fact that the way you can tell that Putin is lying is his lips are moving. That's awesome. Watch his feet. Hips don't lie. Watch where he's going. Watch what he does. That will tell you everything. That this is things we've been praying for, and they're finally happening on a global level. Shoigu, we've talked about this from day one. Since the third day of the war, the fourth day of the war, the 27th of February, we haven't seen Shoigu, the Minister of Defense, the guy who's over this whole thing. He's been missing. What? Where did he go? Well, guess what? He finally reappeared, but he made a very a statement that didn't have a lot of teeth to it. But also, he was slurring his words. There's some thoughts that he might have a heart problem. But the biggest issue is that Putin can't get rid of him, because Shoigu has systematically weeded out all the candidates who could replace him, all the popular generals. And so Putin has no one to put in Shoigu's place. And it looks like there's a rift between Putin and Shoigu. We've been praying for this, the breaks in the system. Putin has sacked nine generals. He's imprisoned the FSB head over this entire operation. Seven generals have killed themselves. Seven colonels have been killed. One colonel killed himself. There is a fundamental destruction of the entire command and control system within Russia, and there is no way that this is something that is irreplaceable. This is fundamentally irreplaceable within the Russian structure. And you can bring more tanks. You can even throw more bodies, but you cannot replace seasoned veteran commanders. You cannot replace the lack of Russian morale. One of the signs of how bad the morale is that they are allowing Russians to begin to soldiers in Bucha, to the northeast of Kyiv, to loot residential apartment buildings. Why is that important? This is extremely reminiscent of 1945 in Berlin, when what happened is the Russians were not able to supply the Russian soldiers, the Soviet soldiers, adequately. So what they did is they promised them they could take anything they wanted from Berlin, and they could become incredibly evil and abuse emotionally, physically, and sexually the people in Berlin. And that led to the 7 days of the horror, the rape of Berlin in 1945. And what this means is they are recognizing that the only way they can motivate Russian soldiers is inviting them to be diabolical. That sounds not like a great prayer of praise, but that means they've come to the end. So here's the answer. Here's the answer. I'm going to switch to prayers in just a second. I'll have to come back to the praises because the answer is Jesus. The only answer is Jesus. One of the things that Russia is really, really, really struggling with on the personal level, human level, is after the rape of Berlin in 1945, these men came back and all the men, all the good men had been killed. All the men, the brave men had died on the front or they had been shipped to the gulag. So all you were left with was the cowards and the people who participated in the rape of Berlin. And these were the men, these were the fathers of the older generation in Russia. And they were told, these are good men, these are good men, these are good men, but they could sense underneath the darkness. You know, we have family members who came back and they were just completely dark. They disappeared into a bottle. And so Russia has this incredibly brittle, almost porcelain view of the good Russian soldiers, and they can't believe the darkness. But we said this before, until Russia confronts the darkness of the Soviet Union, they cannot move forward. And that's how we got here in the first place. And so we're back up to this line already where they have to confront the darkness. And the only answer is Jesus. Only Jesus can deliver, you know, in the same way that he was able to deliver Nazi soldiers after the war, as we saw like in the ministry of Corrie ten Boom. The only way that he can deliver, the only person who can deliver the Russian people from this terrifying delusion is Jesus. And there is a hunger for the gospel in Ukraine right now. Ukrainians are filling the churches. There's revival happening. There is a hunger for a God that can invade hell, and it's happening. There's fire. And so our prayer is that the fire goes from the Ukrainians to the Russian soldiers. These Russian soldiers, pray for them. They are in desperate need. They have been placed in an impossible situation, told to do horrible things, told there was a good reason for it. And then they're having the rug yanked out from under them. They're recognizing this. We've talked about this, how Russian soldiers turned on their own colonel, killed him because of what they're seeing. And so pray for revival. Fire of God. Only God can save these Russian soldiers. Only God. And then these would be the fire that comes back and brings the light of the gospel to Russia, that the truth would win out, that the truth, because only God can deliver them from the hell. Man, oh, the hell of the history of the Soviet Union that they're still living with. Man, oh, man, listen. One of the great things is, we talked about yesterday, there was a massive pushback on the 26th where they destroyed the fourth guard tank unit. Well, that now means the whole section of the Ukraine-Russian border between Sumy and Kharkov is clear. Wow, massive, massive, praise God. and again, the church is pushing back. The church is rising up. We just saw our friends Lily and Vladimir in Dnipro. They've been going into Kharkov. They've been bringing it. Well, guess what? The churches are full in Kharkov. The bombs are falling and the church is full. Actually, the Russian army has pulled back from Kharkov, praise God, but they're still bombing it incessantly. But the people are rising up. They're receiving the gospel. They're being set on fire. Praise God. And the church is rising up and going into hard places. We got word from Vladimir that they've now got a way into Melitopol, deep in occupied territory. They're not afraid to go and bring the light of God into hell. Come on, man. She was able to get handicapped people out of Mariupol. Out of Mariupol. You just don't understand. They had a small car, they packed in them, and the handicapped people had a bunch of big stuff with them. They didn't want to leave behind their stuff, and they filled in the car with bags and stuff, and they took off. Well, they came under fire. All the windows got shot out, and yet, not a single bullet touched a single person. They got stuck in the stuff. God is on the move. The church is not allowing the threats of hell, the threats of danger, the threats of destruction to keep them back. They're rising up. Pray for the church in Kherson. Pray for the church in Melitopol. Pray for the churches in occupied territory to not embrace fear, depression, and despair, but to rise up in courage. We just heard from one of our friends in Odessa. They said, listen, we're great. We're great, man. We're continuing to rise up. There's joy. There's life. Praise God. There's good stuff happening. There is such good stuff happening. Pray that the church continues to be united, continues to be courageous. I'm so grateful for all of you all who've been helping us to provide a resource for the church in Dnipro that is acting as a hub to sending resource and supplies. It's praying for gas. It's paid for a couple of vans or small buses to be able to deliver these things to get refugees out. You guys are part of it. If you want to be a part of giving to that, you can go to ariselife.org/helpukraine. There's information there, and there's a button you can give. 100% of those monies go. We've already sent $56,000 in the last couple of weeks. We're believing for more and more and more because this is not stopping. Man, this is the time. We've been praying for a revival that would grip Ukraine. Fire would consume Ukraine, and out of that fire, it would flood to Russia, and that all of Russia would be set ablaze, and from that, there would come revival that would spread to China, to the rest of the world, to India, to Saudi Arabia, UAE. We're continuing to pray for that all of these governments would be crushed under the weight of God's truth. They would be, that his truth, the gospel, would go into each of these regions that have joined. There's a reason why India, China, UAE, Iran, Saudi Arabia have all joined with Russia to stop this, because these are the countries that are most hostile to the gospel. Pray that they fall under the weight of what's going on, that the truth of the gospel would come forth. Pray for the weak, pray for the poor, pray for the hungry, pray for that, again, the church would be able to find them, that people would be able to get out who need to, and that people who are not supposed to flee would not flee, man. Pray that panic would be dialed back and fire and joy and life would come forth. Pray for the Ukrainians that they would be delivered from rage. Rage is not the friend, man. If the devil can't head you to terror, he's going to head you to rage. No, that they would rise up in power and love and a sound mind, and they would fight back with glory. Wow, wow, wow. God's on the move. God's doing great things. Pray for the Russian people. Pray that a real opposition would rise up, that there would be a real breakthrough. One of the things, I was listening to a report from within FSB that they are in terror of 1917. In other words, of the people rising up and throwing up in rebellion. Wow, man, you know, your fears often tell you what you're empowering. And one of the interesting things is my daughter she found a four-leaf clover and she wanted to press it. And she got a big book from my bookshelf, and it turned out to be Alexander Solzhenitsyn's August 1916. And the interesting thing is I was like, Lord, what's going on? I opened it up, and the description of the state of mind in Russia in 1916 was identical to where we are right now. Don't let the enemy tell you things aren't happening. Things are happening. God is fomenting a real uprising. Pray that, again, that it would be bloodless. Pray that, again, that it would not be back to normal. Pray that, you know, they've talked about, you know, replacing Putin with the head of FSB. That's not an option. We have paid too high a price in life and destruction to have anything less than this whole region on fire for the gospel, this whole region set free from corruption and from domination and control. This is the day the Lord has made, so we're gonna see glory in it. Okay, wow, I'm just so grateful for each of you all. Again, I'm so grateful for our team. I see Gary Phillips here, Ann Say, Lisa Darden. I'm sure there are others. I know Heather McCurry's been jumping on praying for you guys, Amanda Connor, Shannon Lewis, Scott and Sabrina Turner. Listen, if you need prayer for anything, just say need prayer. They'd love to pray for you. We've seen incredible miracles, physical healing, breakthroughs. And so, man, it's so good. But some of you are like saying, listen, I hear you, I hear you, I hear you, but I'm still in fear. I'm still impressed with the darkness. or maybe you're feeling like it's a Pollyanna moment. I got this great quote from one of our favorites, Suzanne Roberts. She shared this with us from Andrew Murray. He said, each time before you intercede, be quiet first and worship God in his glory. Think of what he can do and how he delights to hear the prayers of his redeemed people. Think of your place and privilege in Christ and expect great things. Well, maybe you're saying, I don't know how I can do that. Well, listen, Let me pray for you right now. Listen, some of you are in Ukraine right now, and I'm going to pray right now. You're going to have an encounter with God's glory, His goodness, and His mercy. Because see, we can't climb up to heaven. We can't climb into peace. It's simply a gift we receive. So if you want to do that, just open your hands right now and say, Jesus, I receive. Father, I bless every person right now to receive your goodness and your love and your grace and your power just descending upon them in might. Whoa. Let your goodness invade them, that your joy would bubble up. Man, there's a reason why it's called the peace that passes understanding. That means the peace that makes you feel stupid, that allows you to sleep in the middle of a sinking boat, to sleep with joy. Let your peace, you said your peace would guard the minds of and would keep in perfect peace those whose minds are stayed on you. Lord, I ask right now that they would experience you like never before. In your name, amen. Man, if you're experiencing those things right now, just type in what you're experiencing of God's goodness and grace. Type it in. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if you are struggling financially or physically. Maybe you're hiding in a bunker. Maybe you are. God is right there with you, and He is with you. Man, if He was with Peter in the middle of a jail where he was being held, and the last guy who was held there was killed, and Peter was there chained, God got him out. Listen, it doesn't matter that when Paul and Silas were thrown into a pit, ripped with their bodies ripped apart, facing a death sentence. No, it didn't matter. They began to worship God, and God found them there. Doesn't matter the pit you're in, God is there, and He wants to bring you out. Oh, Jesus. Listen, but some of you are listening, you're like, whoa, I have no idea even what this is, but I want it. I want it. If you've never said yes to God, you never said, this is the God I want to know. Maybe you just didn't even know this was the kind of God He was. Listen, just pray with me right now, because listen, this is an all or nothing thing. Listen, He doesn't save you part way. He doesn't save just your right leg and leave the rest of you in prison. He paid for all of you to be brought out of darkness into His marvelous light, out of fear and terror into holiness and joy. He, man, out of the slavery to sin and brokenness and into beauty and wholeness and righteousness. So what I want to pray right now is that you would experience God's goodness and grace like never before as you give your life, because he gave His life so that you could have His life on the inside. But as long as you and I hold on to our lives, Jesus said, if you attempt to save your life, you'll lose it. As we long to hold on to it, try to protect ourselves, we can't receive His life. So just say right now, Jesus, I give you my life. I can't, I can't, I can't, I can't. I give it to you. I can't protect myself. I can't save myself. I give it to you, and I ask you for your life in return. I receive your life in return. Thank you for giving me your life on the cross, that I might live in you and know your goodness and love. In your name, amen. If you prayed that for the first time, could you type that in? That'd be amazing. That would be amazing, because our team, you say, I did it. Because our team wants to come alongside you and pray for you and encourage you in this new walk in Christ. I love the questions. Someone was just asking about a Pollyanna moment. There was an old movie way back in a Disney movie talking about a girl who just believed the happy things. Well, listen, we don't want to just stare into darkness and go la 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 la. We want to come with fire and with power and true joy, not just denying. Faith does not deny a problem. It denies it a place of influence. It allows God's power to be influential. Listen, some of you guys have many, many, many questions. I appreciate that. I've been thinking about doing kind of an AMA, try to answer questions. If you would be willing, if you have a question that hasn't been answered, a question about the Russian conflict, maybe it's a question about some of the narratives that are being put on, alternative narratives about Putin and everything, and you're wondering about those, you can email us at info@ariselife.org. If one of our team could put up that email, we'll try to put those together, and maybe I'll be able to do a video just talking to dealing with some of those questions, practical questions, maybe historical questions about the conflict, about the invasion, about how we got here, about who is Putin, and what about biolabs, and what about this, and what about human trafficking, whatever. I don't have time for that here. But I'd love to help you guys to process that. Again, some of you have asked, how do you know so much? How can we trust that what you know is true? We are not on the ground in Ukraine, okay? We were missionaries for 7 years in Russia and Ukraine. We have friends, we have family throughout Ukraine and throughout Russia. We have friends on both sides of the border. We have ministry partners on the ground. We're talking with them, but also we have studied this entire region in depth for 30 plus years. My first time in the Soviet Union was 1991. You know, my wife was raised there. So this is our world. This is what we understand. We don't speak of what we don't know. We only speak of what we do know and what we understand from God. So if you got questions, go ahead and send those to info@ariselife.org. Also, again, if you want to be a part of bringing a resource, thank you, Lisa, for posting that. If you want to be part of bringing resource into what's happening, getting people supplies, go to ariselife.org/help Ukraine, and you can find out how to be a part of that there. And if you want to get these in a print form, you can, or a way to read them, you can go to ariselife.org/Ukraine. And there you'll be able to read all about what's going on. And we're so grateful for you all. Have an incredible day, full of His joy, full of His glory, and be blessed. Take care.